Let's pray before we begin. Lord, please let us understand your word and put it in our hearts. May it shape our lives to be more like your Son. In Jesus' name we ask, Amen.
The Second Letter of John. The elder unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not I only, but also all they that have known the truth. For the truth's sake which dwelleth in us, and shall be with us forever. Grace be with you, mercy and peace, from God the Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth, as we have received a commandment from the Father. And now I beseech thee, Lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which we had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in it. For many deceivers are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. Having many things to write unto you, I would not write with paper and ink, but I trust to come unto you and speak face to face, that our joy may be full. The children of thy elect sister greet thee. Amen.
Matthew Henry Commentary on 2 John chapter 1. The epistle of 2 John, or written to John, is like an abridgment of the first. It touches, in few words, on the same points. The lady Electa is commended for her virtuous and religious education of her children, is exhorted to abide in the doctrine of Christ, to persevere in the truth, and carefully to avoid the delusions of false teachers. But chiefly the apostle beseeches her to practice the great commandment of Christian love and charity. Verses 1-3. Religion turns compliments into real expressions of respect and love. An old disciple is honorable, an old apostle and leader of disciples is more so. The letter is to a noble Christian matron, and her children. It is well that the gospel should get among such. Some noble persons are called. Families are to be encouraged and directed in their love and duties at home. Those who love truth and piety in themselves, should love it in others, and the Christians love this lady, not for her rank, but for her holiness. And where religion truly dwells, it will abide forever. From the divine persons of the Godhead, the apostle craves grace, divine favor, and goodwill, the spring of all good things. It is grace indeed that any spiritual blessing should be given to sinful mortals. Mercy, free pardon, and forgiveness, for those already rich in grace, need continual forgiveness. Peace, quietness of spirit, and a clear conscience, in assured reconciliation with God, together with all outward prosperity that is really for good, these are desired in truth and love. Verses 4-6. It is good to be trained to early religion, and children may be beloved for their parents' sake. It gave great joy to the apostle to see children treading in their parents' steps, and likely in their turn to support the gospel. May God bless such families more and more, and raise up many to copy their example. How pleasing the contrast to numbers who spread irreligion, infidelity, and vice, among their children. Our walk is true, our converse right, when according to the word of God. This commandment of mutual Christian love may be said to be a new one, in respect of its being declared by the Lord Christ, yet, as to the matter, it is old. And this is love to our own souls, that we obey the divine commands. The foresight of the decay of this love, as well as of other apostasies, or fallings away, might engage the apostle to urge this duty, and this command, frequently and earnestly. Verses 7-11. The deceiver and his deceit are described. He brings some error concerning the person or office of the Lord Jesus. Such a one is a deceiver and an antichrist. He deludes souls, and undermines the glory and kingdom of the Lord Christ. Let us not think it strange that there are deceivers and opposers of the Lord Christ's name and dignity now, for there were such, even in the apostles' times. The more deceivers and deceits abound, the more watchful the disciples must be. Sad it is that splendid attainments in the school of Christ should ever be lost. The way to gain the full reward is to abide true to Christ, and constant in religion to the end. Firm cleaving to Christian truth unites us to Christ, and thereby to the Father also, for they are one. Let us equally disregard such as abide not in the doctrine of Christ, and those who transgress His commands. Any who did not profess and preach the doctrine of Christ, respecting Him as the Son of God, and salvation by Him from guilt and sin, were not to be noticed and countenanced. Yet in obeying this command, we must show kindness and a good spirit to those who differ from us in lesser matters, but hold firmly the all-important doctrines of Christ's person, atonement, and holy salvation. Verses 12 and 13. The apostle refers many things to a personal meeting. Pen and ink are means of strengthening and comforting others, but to see each other is more so. The communion of saints should be maintained by all methods, and should tend to mutual joy. In communion with them we find much of our present joy, and look forward to happiness forever. Thank you for listening. If you want to know more about Jesus and what the gospel means to you, then hit the video shown on the left of the screen and please don't forget to subscribe. May the Lord Jesus Christ bless your day.